Hello, everyone. I'm Sergeant Major of the Army, retired Dane Daly, and welcome to this edition of Soldier Today Podcast. Soldier Today Podcast is a product of the Non-Commissioned Officer and Soldier Programs Directorate at the Association of the United States Army. Soldier Today subjects focus on those topics that are relevant and needed by our soldiers and their families serving the regular Army, Army National Guard, and the Army Reserve. Continuing our newest discussion topic today is a subject that remains front page news on all of our minds, COVID-19, or what is called the coronavirus. We're all concerned about how this pandemic is impacting Army and military operations worldwide. For all of our listeners around the world, many of them and you and your families have questions and concerns about the coronavirus and how they will impact you in the weeks and months ahead. This hot topic has been in the news and continues to evolve, further impacting our lives. For America's Army, this subject directly impacts soldiers, leaders, and organizational operations at all levels across all three components of the Army. We recently have had discussions with both the Sergeant Major of the Army and the Army National Guard CSM on how this virus is affecting our active and guard forces. But how is COVID-19 affecting our Army Reserve forces? This is a great subject to discuss, and the right leader to have the discussion with here in our virtual studio is our Command Sergeant Major of the United States Army Reserve, Command Sergeant Major Ted L. Copeland. Sergeant Major, thanks for joining us today.
No, it's my pleasure, SMA.
Well, it's great to have you on, and I know we're all excited to hear about an update from our Army Reserve soldiers, and just like all the other soldiers fighting this fight. So let's jump right in, Sergeant Major, with some questions, and let's get to it. So as the weeks begin to pass and we see the crisis lasting for a potentially longer period of time, the Army Reserve has taken precautions to prevent the spread of COVID-19. Sergeant Major Copeland, can you give us insight on how much longer battle assemblies will be canceled as a result of this?
Oh, absolutely. So we like to call them temporary suspended, not canceled. But, you know, our command unit commanders have authority to conduct battle assemblies if they have to when it comes to readiness or our units getting ready for deployment. But, you know, the thing to look at here is that to preserve our force, one, so we don't want to congregate more than 10 and do a battle assembly, but two is also protect our families and our civilians out there, because if the soldiers come together, they spread the virus, then they go back out to the world, because in the Army Reserve world, our soldiers live out in our cities and around the world. So we suspended them just temporary while we're going through this. Probably in the near future, as we see things get better across the board for everybody, then we'll look at starting them back up.
Yeah, absolutely. So they're not canceled, they're suspended. But, you know, as our listeners out there, many of them are Army Reserve soldiers, and many of which depend financially on pay from their battle assemblies. Are there alternative training opportunities for the soldiers?
Oh, absolutely. So we started a new thing called Virtual Soldier Battle Assemblies. So what's that really mean? So that's just basically online battle assemblies. So the Commanding General of the Army Reserve decide we need to still do stuff to build individual readiness and do soldier and Army stuff. So we come up with this concept of Virtual Soldier Battle Assemblies. So the official policy come down from Army Reserve headquarters to the commands. So all the commands are starting to work that. So everybody's, you know, thinking, I'm sure, out there, what's that really mean? So really it means anything you do Army-wise for readiness, could be physical fitness, it could be online training, the soldier can do and get paid for it. So our whole concept here is the commanders will put out some type of training schedule, do these things, soldiers. And then, of course, the first line leaders, our young sergeants out there, will interact with these soldiers and verify they've done it. Once the verification's done, then they'll get paid that month or even make up time if they've missed several battle assemblies, and they'll get paid for it.
Well, that's a great idea and a great concept. So soldiers know and they fully understand that they're going to get full credit for battle assemblies if they do these command-approved virtual or other type of training activities.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, the overarching guidance from the commanding general is let's make this easily done. Let's not complicate it. The military and the Army can sometimes complicate things, especially when it comes to funding and finances. So don't overcomplicate it. All that commander has to do is be able to verify through the leadership down C2 that the soldier did X, Y, or Z, and he'll validate and he'll input for pay. Over the last 3 years, as I travel the battlefield, soldiers always ask me, why don't Army Reserve soldiers get paid for physical fitness? Here's their opportunities. As the command general says, go out and do physical fitness 16 hours a month, and the commander can verify it through their leadership. We'll pay you to do it.
Excellent opportunity. Great way for our soldiers to stay in shape. Sergeant Major, I want to quickly jump on something that you mentioned, finances. You know, in these times, a lot of our soldiers, our Army Reserve soldiers, are out of a job. If they need it, what resources are available for them to seek things like financial assistance during this period?
Yeah, of course, locally, you know, their local organizations like the service organizations, you know, the military service organizations, a good place to go. But one thing that General Lucky did do, he went to Army Emergency Relief and asked for relief on the 30 days active duty time, because for an Army Reserve soldier, they have to be on Title 10 active duty orders for 30 days or beyond to qualify. And AER graciously lifted that ban and said, yep, we'll work with all your soldiers that submit, and we'll lift that requirement. So that's a great opportunity that if we push down. Hopefully the word's getting out, and this will help that word get out. So a soldier struggling because him or her and their spouse is off work, Army Emergency Relief is a good avenue for them.
Yeah, they're a great organization that does a lot for Army, and it's us taking care of ourselves at Army Emergency Relief. So that's great news and great information for our soldiers out there. Shifting subjects a little bit, Sergeant Major, all of us have had to make changes in our lives on how and where we continue to operate. Telework has been the go-to option for many of us. And what is the current telework guidance for the U.S. Army Reserve full-time staff?
So it's the same as the Army as a whole. Work from home, take your Army computer home, work from home. Only very critical staff needs to come in to work. And of course, we push that down through the commanders who'll decide what that is. And they're very, you know, they're very careful. We've closed a few reserve centers temporarily once we found out a soldier or even one of our civilians possibly had COVID-19, so they could disinfect the facility and open it back up. I hate to call it minimal manning because, you know, everybody's at home, whether it's a soldier or a civilian working from home on their Army computer. I know our G6 has expanded the VTC capability, so it's helped broaden that. They made the bandwidth wider on what we use and how we use it, which it seems to be working pretty good for us.
Yeah, we've all had to deal with these challenges, even here at AUSA. During this podcast, Sergeant Major and I are actually in two separate locations taking advantage of some digital capabilities. So you're right, Sergeant Major, you can still get the mission done, and it's not minimally manned. It's just relocating of the force. So
absolutely.
By the Army Reserve. So all across the force, there seems to be a concern about how COVID-19 will affect promotions and professional military education. And we talked to both the SMA and the National Guard CSM, but promotions are different across all three components. And what has the Army Reserve done to ensure COVID-19 does not negatively impact career progression for our NCOs?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, of course, we're following the Army's policy on the step suspension to E6, E7. Don't mean they don't have to do their professional military education, just means they'll have to do it before they hit their next gate for their next promotion. Now, for our E4 to E5 population, we're setting up a BLC online, just like the whole Army is. Only thing, the soldier has to be CAC-enabled. Don't need a military computer, but CAC-enabled. You know, they can get on the Army Blackboard without the CAC, but there's another system they have to log on with their CAC. And so far, we seem to be pretty good. And the instructors have called each soldier individually and said, can you do this? Do you have the ability? So soldier asking, how do I get in that? So we've already missed a couple BLC starts. So what Camp Parks did was they went back to those two classes and they started calling the soldiers. And if they're good to go, they got rolled into the online course.
That's good. We're taking advantage of that online capability. And it's great that our NACPS Officer Professional Development System has those capabilities. But for some of them, though, it just can't happen. We had to cancel some professional military education. So, Major, can you tell us, will soldiers be able to be rescheduled for those courses once we return to normal?
Yeah, there will be limitations. I know our 80th Training Command oversees all our training, so they're doing an evaluation now on if we're able to start back on this date, how many seats could we make up? How fast could we do a few more courses? Of course, you know, in the Army Reserve, we train ourselves, so we're limited on facilities, instructors, and time. So we're working that hard right now to see, okay, say if 1 August is the date of start back to normal operations, how many courses could we make up? How can we expand the seat load for the courses? And we're still working that. I know that we have another course starting 30 April with 200 seats out of Fort McCoy, Wisconsin. 7 March, Fort Dix is doing one with 256 seats. And originally, those are 160 seats. So we've expanded them already to get more soldiers in because some of the other courses aren't being conducted at all. So we have the excess instructors, so we're going to put them to work.
Yeah, it's going to be critical to make sure that we fill those seats because, like you said, we're going to have to maximize our capabilities and even expand them in the future. But a no-show or two is really going to hurt us along the way, won't it?
No, absolutely. I tell you, this is a prime time for our soldiers. As you said earlier, a lot of them are out of work right now. So financially, this makes sense. And I tell you what we're doing, so the soldiers know, they're going to be put on a 22-day active duty order because they're going to be sitting at that computer 7, 8 hours or more a day for 22 days because they got to do a video, they got to do several other projects to upload. So prime opportunity for our young soldiers that, struggle with full-time employment or going to college full-time and doing Army Reserve duty or doing extra Army Reserve duty above battle assembly by going to school. So this is a great opportunity for them.
Yeah, great example, an opportunity that you can take advantage of right now for our soldiers. So Major, when the crisis hit, we had soldiers serving all over the world and on deployments, as well as attending schools and professional development courses. What should soldiers do if they're currently on temporary duty, attending a military school or training away from home?
So we're following the main Army policy. So if you're out on temporary duty, once that's over, so if it was a schooling, they stayed, finished schooling, and they're allowed to return to home. If they were just on TDY for a conference or other kind of meetings, they come home right away. I believe we got everybody home that was out on TDY. We had a few stuck in Morocco because Morocco shut down their airports when it really hit in Morocco. But I believe we got them all home now, so I think we're good. Everybody that was out, I believe, has returned.
That's good news to hear that our soldiers are at least home and safe where they can be taken care of by our great Army Reserve. So I'd like to shift focus of our questions to how the situation affects our individual soldiers and how they may be personally affected by this situation. As we're all aware, our soldiers rely on their well-deserved benefits. How will suspended battle assemblies affect reserve component soldiers and their service members group life insurance or SGLI benefits?
If they're enrolled currently in SGLI, those benefits won't change. Even if they possibly don't get paid for any battle assemblies or make them up, as some of these opportunities I've talked about, they will continue the coverage and then their monthly premium will just roll. Basically, they'll have a debt. So when they get back to battle assemblies and start getting paid, they'll get taken out over several months. So, no, their life insurance will be good to go. It will not be canceled.
Well, that's great news. And we all know how important medical care is, especially in a time now. How will this impact reserve component soldiers and their TRICARE benefits?
Well, that's a good one because, a lot of soldiers, I hope, would realize, but some don't. We do not take for TRICARE. They have to pay that themselves through their own bank account and their own direct deposit. However they decide to do it, it does not come out of the Army Reserve pay. That's not set up. We don't have that capability. So as long as they keep paying it, where they're rolled in auto pay or they have to go in and push the button every month, they just got to remember to keep doing that. So if they're in TRICARE now, as long as they keep paying their monthly premiums, it should not have an effect on them.
Well, that's great. And well, how will the suspension of battle assemblies affect Army Reserve soldiers who are trying to complete enough points toward a good retirement year?
Yeah, so that's a good one. A lot of, if you're not in the Army Reserve or you haven't been very long, it's hard to understand. But if you're a good drilling Army Reserve soldier, you get 15 points a year. They call them membership points. You only need 50 points a year for a good Army Reserve year for retirement. So 15 right off the top, you're down to 35. So most of the soldiers have drilled probably 4 or 5 months already. So they already got 20. So that's 35 points. So if they do some of these options we gave them, whether it's electronic-based digital learning online courses that we offer and get retirement points for, they do some of the virtual battle assemblies, they'll be good for the year. They just need 50 minimum, and most of them are almost there already, so they should be good to go.
Well, that's good news to hear that there's plenty of opportunities for them to have a good retirement year. And I know that many of our soldiers, at least the ones that have planned to stay with us for a long time, are concerned about that. So it's great news to hear, Sergeant Major. Many of our Army soldiers and leaders are doing some really incredible things. We see examples of that on the news all the time. And they're doing it for our Army and for our nation and its people. Can you share some of the inspiring things that you've seen so far while responding to the virus?
I tell you, there's a lot of examples. Some of the ones right off the top of my head are the Urban Augmentee Medical Task Force, the ULOG, they call them. And these are our medical professionals, and we've put them into an 85-soldier team with, the different doctor specialties, the different nurses, the medics. and currently 10 are deployed across the United States, a lot of them to New York area, up in that area. But these are medical professionals that we didn't take them out of any place that if they're fully engaged with COVID-19 already, we didn't take them out. But they all volunteered, said, yep, I'm good to go. I'm not engaged. Left their families. We aggregated in locations, and they've been shipping out in the last week and a half to go into these hot zones and help our civilian counterparts take care of our civilians. So that's just one right there, the selflessness of these soldiers, these professionals that said, hey, I'm willing to go into this hot environment, put myself at risk to help our fellow citizens. And then we have about 1,500 other soldiers currently on orders that are supporting AR North, NORTHCOM, who's the lead for this fight. We have the lead on all the sustainment operations. We have the lead on the overarching framework for the medical task force. So our soldiers are out here. They left their families. They're out there supporting our citizens and taking the fight to the COVID-19.
Well, Sergeant Major, we all appreciate what our soldiers are doing out there and the great work that our Army Reserve soldiers are doing. I'd like to shift focus of questions here just one more time, Sergeant Major. And I've been told that, unfortunately, your time has come to an end as the Army Reserve CSM. Could you tell us a little about who your replacement is and when that transition is going to occur?
Yep. You're right. I'm down about a couple months, a month probably. Depends on what's going on with COVID-19, because the incoming is Command Sergeant Major Andrew Lombardo. He's actually a New York City police officer, so he's very, he's up to his neck in this fight currently. So the projected time him coming on board is May 12th. Looks like that's probably going to be okay. We're just not sure yet. It just depends on how things are going up there for him, because as I said, he's definitely in the fight. He's a fellow MP like myself, so yep, you're all getting another military policeman up here. But very good guy, great CSM. He'll do a good job for the Army Reserve.
Yep, and we've already reached out to Sergeant Major, and we're looking forward. Of course, it'd be terrible to see you leave, Sergeant Major, but he's a great man coming in to replace you, and as we always do in the Army, transition is a good thing. So what's next for you, Sergeant Major? What's in the store for the Copeland family?
Well, that's a good question. Probably don't have a 100% answer, but I'm heading back to Ohio. That's where my family's at. I've been doing this on my own for the last 3 years, so I'll head back to Ohio. Good question. Get back with the family. I got 6 grandkids. Get back with the grandkids. Besides seeing them on FaceTime on my phone, it'll be better to see them in person, every day. Keep doing, I like to do some woodworking and projects, craft stuff. So I'm going to kind of go that route, probably look for a third career, third job for a while, and we'll see what a few years brings.
Well, Sergeant Major, I'll tell you, I want to personally thank you for your lifelong dedication to our Army. And as many people may or may not know, also your lifelong dedication to law enforcement prior to coming on active duty as the Sergeant Major. You were finishing out your career as a law enforcement professional there in Ohio. So I'm sure there's great things in store for you and your family in the future. And we're going to miss you, Sergeant Major. Sergeant Major, and it's always a pleasure to have you with us. And I'd like to give you the last words. And do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to provide our listeners?
I tell you, Sergeant Major, our soldiers out here are doing great things, where it's, active component, National Guard, Army Reserve, we're one Army. They're out here taking the fight, helping our citizens. It's not a better time to be in the military or any of the organizations, just not the Army. And, the selflessness service that they've stood up, they've left their families behind during these trying times, and they're out here helping our fellow citizens. Just a great time for our military.
Well, thank you, Sergeant Major. We appreciate time with you and also appreciate everything you and your soldiers are doing. Unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, our time has come to an end to close this edition of Soldier Today podcast. All of us here at the Association of the United States Army want to thank Command Sergeant Major Ted Copeland for joining us today for this great update on our Army Reserve soldiers and COVID-19. As Army alums, I can say from all of us across the country, we thank you and all of your soldiers for everything you do each and every day and all that you continue to do. Thank you for continuing the proud traditions of our Army. And this is another example of how fortunate we are and how this contributes to us being the greatest land power force in the world.
To all our listeners, thanks for joining us. Be sure to subscribe to the Army Matters podcast on iTunes and everywhere podcasts are found. Join us next Monday with a brand new episode of Army Matters with Army Real Talk. The Army Matters podcast series is brought to you by the Association of the United States Army, the U.S. Army's Professional Association, member supported, Army connected. Visit us at AUSA.org for more information or to become a member. Your membership helps AUSA continue to carry out its mission to educate, inform, and connect with the Total Army, our industry partners, and our supporters of a strong national defense. For questions or to provide topic recommendations, email us at podcast@AUSA.org. Have a great Army Day. Hua.